survival is creative, and I'm going to share from my heart. And that will sort of spark something rather phenomenal that happens in your playing time.
Good day, Jessica. Welcome back to Talking Harps. How are you doing today?
I'm really good. Thank you so much for having me again, lovely Victoria.
Yes, I have been thinking about this chat for a while, and this is actually going to be the first full-length conversation I'm recording for Talking Harps in 2024. I think when I came into this new year, I have gone through some personal situations that caused me to think about how big a role music has played for me in my life. And I think about your story, which we're going to talk a lot about today. And I'm really looking forward to this chat. Now, before we get started, I want to say that we're going to be talking about how you use music in your own healing journey as a trauma survivor and sexual assault trauma survivor. And we're going to be talking about this topic, which could be very emotionally challenging for some folks who are watching. While we're not going to be going into a lot of the details of the incident, I think it is important for us to be able to name the topic so that we have the proper context for the chat that we're going to have today. And if you're not in the right mind space to listen to this topic and decide to stop right now, we want you to know that we see you and we love you, and we would love to see you at another time. If you know someone or yourself who is in need of help, you can visit wellnesstogether.ca if you're in Canada, or look up for other mental health resources that are in your area to support you. You, Jessica, will be embarking on a tour to speak about your experience and sharing that experience with folks in a number of universities across the United States. And I have the honor to preview this talk. Now, I really don't know if talk is the right word. For me, it feels more like an experience that you are bringing the audience together with you. But what's more interesting for me is that there are a number of messages in this talk that I think are very relevant to who you are, the work that you do, and also to the harp and music, which is what we here in Talking Harps care about. I want us to talk about the power of community as well, because that is another vision that I have for Talking Harps. So those are the things that we are going to be discussing today. And I invite you to come here to listen to Jessica's own healing journey and how she's going to be bringing this to the world as she go on with her work. And I'm gonna actually turn the table to you, because in the talk, you have set the stage really well and also lead the audience through a briefing exercise. Can you walk us through that?
Sure. And I just want to say thank you again, Victoria. I know this is a complex and sort of sticky topic to even, you know, be open to talking about. And I just want to say to all of the viewers, we're creating a safe space for each other. And what that means is that it is okay to not be okay. So again, as Victoria said, if this feels too much, just turn it off. If you need to go and get some water or come back to it or watch it several times in a slow way, not the whole time at once, just know that we see you and we're with you. And it's really important to take care of yourself and to listen to what's going on in your body. So throughout the talk, I'm going to be doing what I call wind through the trees breathing exercises. So it's a way for us to come into our body and for us to be really home in these magnificent bodies we have. So what you do is you breathe in through your nose, hold it for 1 second, and then breathe out through your mouth like wind through the trees. Great. Let's do it again. Breathe in through your nose, fill up your belly. Last time, breathe in through your nose, fill up your belly. Really good. And I'll probably keep saying, let's do another breath, because it helps us come back and be in our bodies. So throughout the talk, I will be sprinkling in my actual healing through music talks, and probably in our interview, I just might say, let's take a breath. So.
Wonderful. Now, we could easily just say that you're a trauma survivor, but it is very important for you to name that you are a sexual assault survivor. Tell us why that is important and how it helps in your healing.
So for a long time, and even when I started writing this album, I just sort of called it Trauma Survivor. And I had before previously done one of these healing through music talks and actually used the word sexual assault survivor. And something that I've realized is as a culture, we don't have space. We don't create this safe space for survivors. And very often, survivors of sexual assault are made to feel like it was their fault, or that they should feel guilty or ashamed about this. So, I'm gonna say a statistic and then we're gonna take a breath. But in the United States, and actually, this is the same statistic I found for Canada as well, one in three women in their lifetime will be a survivor of sexual assault. Two in three of our trans siblings, so people that identify as transgender, and one in six men in the United States and one in 11 men in Canada survive sexual assault in their lifetime. So let's take a breath. So when you really want to think about those statistics, and think about all the different women you know. There are so many women and transgender people and men that survive sexual assault, and then in our culture are left with really no openness or resources which are made available. And another word that I think is important to use, although it's a really hard phrase, is rape culture. And what that means is that often survivors of sexual assault are made to feel like they did something wrong and they caused this. Or if they speak about it, they're made to feel like, oh, this, I should feel ashamed about this. So I'm not going to talk about it. I know that even in reporting, I think it's only 2 to 3%, depending on what statistics you look at, of rape cases are actually reported in many ways because people are made to feel, even in that process, humiliated or embarrassed. And I don't think until we can, as a culture, really look at this and look at how many people it affects, how can we ever really heal? And there's a phrase that I really like that says that the cure for the pain is the pain. The Rumi, the poet, who I named our son after, says this. And I think that unless, as a culture, we can at least begin to acknowledge and use the actual word sexual assault, we can't really start to heal from it. And it was an interesting process. And I just want to say thank you to Talking Harps for using this word. I've done some interviews, most of them, a few have come out, but I was really surprised with how many interviews I've done in preparation for these talks just use trauma survivor. And it made me realize we have to use this word. I'm using this word. I'm not embarrassed about using that. It's been a long process for me to not feel shame, but I don't think until we use this word and we're able to openly welcome survivors and say that you did nothing wrong. I believe you. I'm with you. I'm going to be here with you in this journey. We can't really start the healing process. So in my talk, I have a whole minute of silence where we are just with survivors. And I know we don't have a whole minute here. But I'd just like us to take maybe 10 seconds where we can just have a moment of being in silence and present with survivors. Is that okay for you,
Of
Victoria?
course.
Okay, so what I'm going to ask people to do, I really want for us in this 10 seconds to feel like we can hold ourselves. And so for survivors to feel like that they're held, that they hold themselves. And even if you're a friend of a survivor or a family member, it's a lot to carry. So I'm just going to ask us to put one hand on our heart and maybe another on our belly, or a way where you feel loved and held and seen. And just breathe for these 10 seconds and say to yourself, I see you. Okay, so let's just take this 10 seconds. And I want you to know, all survivors, all friends of survivors, all family members, that I see you and we are in this together. Thank you.
In my own experience, talking to therapists and some of my friends, we always talk about the importance of being able to name it before we can own it and tame it. So I think what you have demonstrated there is that we need to be able to name the problem before we can take care of it. So thank you very much for sharing that. Tell us about your story, because I think it's important for us to understand how that has shaped what you're doing right now.
So, and I just again trigger warning, I'm not going to go into a lot of details, but I will use the words for what happened to me. So take, that as a little trigger warning. So I am a professional harpist, as we all are here, we're all harpists. And when I was 10 years old, my uncle moved in with my family at our home. And while he lived with us, he molested, raped, and I use the word tortured me. And for a long time, I just sort of put it, I say it's like I had a day child and a night child. I just sort of, the night child sort of survived the sexual abuse, and the day child just kept on with life. And when I was 13, so this happened when I was 10. And when I was 13, I became anorexic the year before. And at 13, I finally spoke about the abuse after being hospitalized for anorexia. And that started a whole long, I guess, 9-year court process. Because I was a minor, my therapist had to report this to the police. And then there was this very, very long, very painful court process, where my uncle was convicted once and then it was overturned, and then he was convicted a second time and finally went to prison when I was 22, I believe, or 21. And I left the United States to go and kind of heal on a as far away as I could. So I went to New Zealand and again started to kind of go back on my HARP journey. And that's led me to, through using the harp and becoming a professional harpist, really taking music and trying to process what happened to me. I've done a lot of therapy, done a lot of yoga, done a lot of spiritual journeying, but the heart of it for me was really to try to come back into my body, to try to be at peace again. And music and the harp continually have saved my life. So, oh, and now we live on a sailboat. Through that all, I ended up living in France and met my husband, and we bought a sailboat. And the backdrop for that was to use the sailboat to share my music. And what's been interesting is through becoming a parent and crossing the ocean several times, it's really become incredibly clear to me that it's not just the music, but it's healing through music that's become the real strong message of what we're doing, and I believe what I'm doing just in general with the harp.
That's incredible. And we're definitely going to be dive into a lot more detail about that. But you in your talk have some really interesting science and research that you have shared that I think is very important for us to hear about it. So I would like to talk about that before we get back to the sailboat and your harp. So first thing first, you have talked about how trauma changes our brain. And also when we heal, that also changes our brain. Tell us about that.
So in general, I feel like when someone survives some kind of trauma, it's almost like, and it is scientifically, the whole brain is rewired, and the whole body, the nervous system responds to stress differently. The way that someone experiences memories or everything, emotion, everything changes. And I just think it's important to begin to have an understanding of that, because for a long time, I felt like I was crazy. And I have spoken to so many survivors who feel like who are very, very intelligent women and people, and who feel like, what is wrong with me? And I think it's just important to state that this is what happens after trauma. But when we choose to look at it, and when we choose to come home again, healing also changes the brain. And I think in many ways, it opens the heart. So I'll get into that part in just a minute. But let me talk your question about, let me respond to your question about what happens in trauma. And I think that this is really fascinating, and there's not enough, we don't have enough experiences where we're actually told about this. People are just left to feel crazy. So when a stressful event happens, the amygdala, which is a part in the center of our brain responsible for fear, emotion, anger, it immediately sends a signal saying, there is a bear chasing me, there is a disaster, and I must flight or fight, I have to get away from this. The whole body kind of turns on, and the amygdala tells the hippocampus to release cortisol, to release all of these hormones. The autonomic nervous system, again, sends the whole body into, there is a disaster, we must, you know, save our lives. So that is a one-time stressful experience. And what's fascinating is, if there is a repeated or very, 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 like in the case of someone who survives rape, an incredibly very stressful, horrific experience, the amygdala then becomes hyper-aroused. And if there is even a little trigger, a smell, a similar experience, a sound, often these are not even conscious. They're what we would call body memories. The amygdala immediately sends the same response system to the whole, you know, the whole brain. And survivors, at least I've known this about myself and many other survivors that I've spoken to, will have become really triggered extremely easily and feel again crazy. Why am I having this body response? And it's actually because the brain has trained itself to try to avoid this kind of stressful situation. And something that's even more interesting is there's this incredible book, The Body Keeps Score. I highly recommend it. Oops. The Body Keeps Score, by Dr. Bessel van der Kolk. And it talks all about how the body responds to trauma. But when there's been repeated trauma, the hippocampus, which is how we see ourselves in space and time, how we remember memories, also our understanding even of how we look in the mirror, is found to be damaged in survivors of repeated trauma, or what they would call complex post-traumatic stress disorder, people that live with it. And what's interesting for me about this is a lot of survivors of sexual abuse in their memories don't actually remember their trauma like you would remember going to the grocery store or what you ate yesterday. They're stored in body memories. A lot of my own memories, I'm almost above my body, or I can't figure out really what's happening. It's very confusing. And some people also have what is called repressed memories. I had some of my memories came out much later when I was in a safe space to sort of be able to process them. But my most traumatic memories actually came out much, much, much later, even after the trial. And I've known so many survivors that this is the case. And I think it's important to say that this is not because they are crazy. This is because their brain did a beautiful job of protecting them and even, making the hippocampus smaller so that their memories are stored in a way that they can process the memories later when it's a safe enough space for them. But I think there's something so powerful and beautiful about our brain that it takes trauma and deals with it in a different way than we would normal experiences. And it's not because the brain is broken, but it's really because the brain, I believe, is our best friend and is trying to help us survive something so traumatic to when it's the right time be able to process it. And so I think there is a part of understanding trauma and what happens in the brain, but it's really positive in many ways if you look at it as, oh, my brain did this to save me, and now I am in a safe enough space. So all of the flashbacks that I'm having, all of these memories, all the body memories, this it feels horrible and it does feel like hell. But the fact that you're going through it almost means that I mean, it does mean that you're in a space now that it's time to process it. You're safe enough to process it. So thank you, our beautiful brains and our beautiful bodies, for working so hard with us to survive these incredible, horrible events.
Our body is so magnificent and magical in its own way. And you have shared even more interesting facts about our body that reminds me what kind of magic we're doing on a daily basis. Tell us about that.
Yeah, so as I briefly mentioned, I struggled with eating disorders for a long time and toxic relationships, and I wouldn't say I struggled with like alcoholism, but I know I have used alcohol to sort of not feel as much in the past. And so there was a big part of me that needed to come home into my body and realize that the body wasn't the war zone. And I think that's what a lot of, at least I felt, is that something was wrong with my body, that it survived these events, but maybe, it was my body's fault. And so being able to change that paradigm and say, oh no, my body is my best friend, is magic, is this vessel that I can live in for this life. So here are my facts about the body. Pound for pound, your bones are stronger than steel. So we are made with incredible internal strength. Our ears never stop growing. Our fingernails and our toenails and our ears actually never stop growing, making us lifelong listeners and learners. Our cells, every minute, create 25 million new cells in our body. So we are constantly architecture. We're constantly remaking ourselves into something magnificent. We have two different types of tears. We have tears that are caused by pain, physical pain, and then we have emotional pain tears. And our emotional pain tears actually fall slower down our cheek, inviting those around us to come to our aid because we are communal people. We heal in community. And our heart actually has an electromagnetic field that goes at least 8 to 10 feet in and around us all the time. So when we meet someone and we say, oh, I feel your energy, I feel your heart, we literally do. And finally, as I've just spoken about, are the way that our mind and brain processes trauma is, I believe, a huge way and a very adaptive way of helping us survive those traumas until we are in a safe enough space to process this. So, yes, my friends, these magnificent bodies can play harps and dance and make art and do all these things and are our true companions for life.
It's so lovely to hear that, and I really resonate with the ear growing and making us better listener. I think to me that's a really interesting things to for us to think about what our body is potentially sending us in terms of messages of, you know, what we should do as in throughout our lifetime. It's fascinating. Now let's go back to the amygdala that is controlling our flight or flight. And there's this phenomenon called amygdala hijack, which literally took over our sort of response system. And we can use music to help calm it and soothe it. Tell us about that.
I'm really excited about this. I'm gonna have to remind myself to not talk so fast. Okay, so there's so many different things. The first thing to know about the amygdala is, you know, it's not bad. We can even like call it Amy the amygdala, like she's our friend. When this amygdala hijack happens, it's a quicker response to go straight to the amygdala than to go to the prefrontal cortex, which is how we can rationalize. So if you smell a smell, which is triggering something that, you know, reminds you of your abuser or whatever, your amygdala immediately kind of takes that on. Your prefrontal cortex could just say like, oh, this is just this person's perfume. It's okay. Let's get out of here and just sort of take some breaths. But your amygdala kind of goes into that. So if you find yourself in an amygdala hijack, which is okay, it happens to us all, there's several different things that you can do. So any kind of bilateral stimulation, anything which is left and right stimulation is extremely calming for the amygdala. It's why if you look at mothers with babies, what do? We rock them back and forth. It's very calming and soothing. And something that you can do with yourself also, there's something called EMDR therapy, which actually was not very helpful. I did try this therapy. It was not the most helpful for me, but I know a lot of survivors that it is. And again, it's a part of this bilateral left and right stimulation. And with music, there's a lot of really wonderful music that you can have, which has bilateral, binaural, it's called sounds coming from different ears. And one of the songs on my last album, Whale, we actually used this with a producer where we had different claps coming and different sounds coming on from different sides, left and right stimulation. And the concept was this creates some kind of really healing, almost like you're with your inner shaman experience for people. Show you something right now. It's going to involve, it's called the Brahmari breath, which is a yoga. It's called pranayama. That means a breathing exercise in yoga. And it involves also something called a butterfly hug. So we're gonna be doing a few different things here. Let's just get ready. So first things first, put your hands in front of you like this. Okay, now you're gonna put your hands like this. Gonna clip your thumbs together. And you're just going to tap one side and then the other. Listen and feel what feels good for your body. So some people need a faster tap. I kind of like a really strong, slow tap, but feels and feel if it feels better for you, if it's softer or harder. Like listen to what feels calming for your body. And then what we're going to do is you're going to go left to right with your just rock back and forth. I am on a boat. So I am like, this is like an amusement park ride to me right now. But just go back and forth. That's great. And remember to breathe. It's wonderful. And when you feel ready, I'm going to do this before you do it, but I'm going to just take a breath in and I'm going to hum. This is the Brahmari breath. It's called the sweet bee breath. And pick a note that just feels good for you. There's no right or wrong answer. Just something that feels healing. So let me show you how we do this. Breathe in. Really good. And you can pick a higher note or a lower note. Just pick something which feels soothing. And the energy that you should feel after you do this. It's just kind of comforted, like your own mom or someone that you love just sang you a lullaby. You sing it to yourself. Okay, I'm going to do it one more time, and I invite you to do this in the safe space of your home or wherever you are. Wonderful. Take one more deep breath wherever you are. Come back to the center. And take one of those wind through the trees breaths. So breathe in through your nose, fill up your belly, out through your mouth. Release. And see how you feel in your body after doing that. When you are really stressed, and if you're in one of those amygdala hijacks, try this and don't think about it. That's what I like about this exercise. You don't have to think. And the goal isn't to think, calm down, I gotta calm down. It's really to just let the movement, let the humming, let that really good, safe body touch that you're doing to yourself bring you back. And that's a really kind of little trick you can do with music, but any kind of singing, any kind of music actually really helps. And I'm just going to say this because we're harpists. So the fact that we're like left and righting, you know, and like playing, and there's all these vibrations, playing the harp itself, I think they just need to put in every, you know, like a trauma therapy center in the world, and just let people feel those vibrations. Let people feel that, you know, incredible left and right hand stimulation. And another thing that I didn't really talk about, when you're doing something where you cross the center of your brain like this, which we don't really cross fully the center of our bodies in harp playing, but we're often looking at the harp or looking back at the music or what have you. That again is something which invites the brain to make those really good connections to come back, to not be in amygdala hijack. So the harp has a whole space in healing and therapy that I don't think has been really fully explored.
I
Gonna
think
help
there's
you.
a lot of opportunity to explore that for sure. And I think a lot of us innately have that association that playing the harp is very calming and soothing. And I think you have just given us some reasons as to why that might be. Now, I want to talk about your boat here. In your conversation, curious one with us in Harp Connection, you told us that you're living a boat and you also mentioned it in here. And I'm going to put a clip of a boat tour of where you're right now, so we can take a look at your surroundings.
Ahoy, Talking Harps! Welcome to our boat and welcome to my harps. I'm going to show you two of my three harps. So this is my DHC incredible Camac harp that has gone all over the world. I love her with all of my heart and harp. Here is our boat. It's a beautiful day today in St. Martin. I'm going to take you inside. This is the bar where we steer. Here is the kitchen. This is Rumi's play space. Ooh, a little window to see outside. Here we come. Hello, everyone. This is Rumi's little studio where he plays piano. Here's our room. There's Rumi's room. I'm gonna go show you my music writing cabin. Come through here. This is my harp case. Very important for traveling harpists to have. You can see it's very cool. We have skateboard wheels at the end. Whoa, big waves. And we come here. Welcome to my cabin. This is my Odyssey harp. This is where I go to create music. It's my Zen space. Over here, I have a bunch of inspirational materials. Usually I have my sound system set up, but I don't today. And I invite you all to have a space where you can go connect with your heart and harp and create and make music. So thank you for coming on board with us.
You have talked about sailing on this boat in the ocean. And I remember you describing sort of that feeling of being all by yourself at night in this big blue sea with nothing around you. And you have also in your talk about going into the water and seeing nothing but miles and miles of blues around you. And you describe that as going into the void. Tell us about that experience and what have that done for you?
So to just clarify a little bit, what happens on a boat when you cross an ocean, which we have done twice, and I'll talk about that later, but we're getting ready to do again. But when you cross a long period of ocean, you can't stop at the store and grab some snacks and water and like fill up. You're in the ocean and there's nowhere to stop. So people are on watch at all hours. It's not that you're sailing the whole time. You're not, there's something called an autopilot, which steers the boat, but you have to make sure that the sails are okay. And also at nighttime that you're not, you know, hitting a boat that doesn't have radar or what have you. Someone is always on watch. And I love these moments because I can finally be alone. I really love that juicy, introverted alone time to create, to just be with myself, to reset. I pretend to be an extrovert a lot, but I'm a hardcore introvert. So at nighttime, you're in this space where there is nothing. You can only see stars. And when we talk about stars, we see, you know, a few stars at night, depending on where we are. But in the middle of the ocean, you see galaxies, you see the Milky Way, you see stars forever. And those are sort of the closest things, even though they're the furthest away, but that's what feels closest. And this blue that just goes on forever. So it's one of the most healing and sometimes terrifying experiences at the same time. And I realized that kind of later that there's a movement like this. Again, it's that rocking, that bilateral stimulation that has happened very continuously every time we've crossed the ocean. And every single time we've done this, I feel like there's this huge other layer of healing from my sexual abuse that happens, of dealing with it, of understanding it. And I write every time we cross the ocean so far. I've also written an album. And this last time was, I guess, almost a year, 2 years ago now. But it was so clear to me that the music written this album was directly about healing from sexual abuse. And I didn't go into this thinking, oh, I'm going to write this album and it's going to be about healing from sexual abuse. I kind of actually thought I've dealt with this, I've healed this, now I'm a mother, now I'm gonna do other things. When you make plans, like, just get ready there, laugh and see what happens. But the process of crossing the ocean, of having all this alone time, it's like it so clearly came to me that this is what you're meant to be doing right now. And your music, in a very, very deep way, it's right now about healing from sexual assault and being with others in that journey. So one specific song and moment that comes to me was in this middle of the night watch. You know, I think it must have been 2 or 3 a.m. I brought out this harp. So this is the Odyssey harp. And funny enough, My very, very ever first harp was this exact same color. And I didn't mean when I got this harp from Camac, I think this was one of the only colors they had at that time. So I said, okay, but I didn't realize it was going to be the exact same color. And so there's something about specifically that harp, which is very much healing the inner child, the same age I was when I was raped. I had my first harp, you know. So there was something in playing this harp, which was like I played this specific part of the child in me whose voice was silenced. And that night, so I have this harp and I'm looking up, there's a full moon, and I felt this really powerful resonance with the moon. And it felt like I was looking at her in awe. And at the same time, I felt like she was looking at me with that same beauty. And so I say this to all the survivors out there. That's also how I look at you when I see you and what you've gone through and all that, you know, all that you've survived and that you continue to live. And I think all of us, for all of us, any we've all survived such painful things, but we're still here trying to not take the pain and you know, putting it out or keeping it inside, but really healing and trying to create community. So this song, what happened was I started to do this like tapping, which is again this bilateral, but I didn't, you know, think about that at the time. And this really powerful song, Moonwalk, just came out. And a lot of times I feel like when I write music, it just sort of comes pouring out of me. Those are the best songs. They don't really think about it. It just, it's like it needs to kind of wash through me. And I think that is another powerful thing that music can do if we let it kind of flow through us, almost like air through a flute. But it heals us and it brings us back to who we are. So that was a really long answer.
They will wonder how to be free.
Fascinating journey, and I really like how that theme of the bilateral simulation keep coming up in your music, in your life on a boat, and in how you take care of yourself, walking us through that exercise that we did earlier. And I cannot wait to dig into whale again and hear those nuances, because it's so subtle, but it's calming and soothing that like I didn't even notice that it was happening for me when I was listening to it. In this album, not only do you play the harp, you sing as well. And in your talk, Healing Through Music, you talk about finding and using your voice. So not only finding it, but also use it. And something that you say that really struck with me, and I'm reading off a piece of paper because I don't want to misquote. You said, when we use our voice, we say, I'm here. You will not do this to me. I will survive. And this is my voice. I thought that was really powerful. And your voice have really came through with your harp. Tell us about this album that you wrote, Her Odyssey. How have this process give you back more of your voice, of that inner child?
Yeah. Oh, such a great question. When someone survives something as traumatic as a sexual assault, it's literally like your whole autonomy is taken from you. Your body isn't your own anymore. And there's a real silencing, a real violence towards the self that happens. And I think for any survivor, being able to say, this happened to me, this is my truth, and to have it received. And that's why in the talk I have different sections, but one of them is I believe you. And I think there is something so powerful for survivors to just feel heard and seen. And when, as a survivor, you speak your truth, there is again that reclaiming of this is me, this happened to me, and I am choosing to survive. I am choosing to use my voice for healing, for good, for life, and not to destroy myself or others. In using art or music or anything, there's a real choice that happens where instead of taking the violence done and doing what I did for many years, hurting myself or internalizing it, or, you know, putting it back at others in toxic relationships. But instead of doing that and taking it inside and putting it out through creativity, through dance, through art, through music, there's a whole nother step of reclaiming your voice again. And I did say this a little bit, but every single harp I have, I feel it represents a part of me that was silenced. So the very, you know, the Odyssey harp, it's like my child self having her voice again. My electric harp, it's like this sort of young adult woman self. And my classical harp is like my woman self. So there are these different voices that in many ways, through different experiences in life, I have felt were silenced. And so when you choose to use your voice to sing, there's a mystery, a truth that you can again grasp and share with others. So I think there is, for any survivor of trauma that had something that another person did to them, there is something so powerful about using your voice to reclaim your truth. And there's a lot of mystical creation stories that actually talk about, like, grandmother spider knitting the world together through her song. Or in the Indian tradition, there's the Hindu tradition, there's Krishna who blows the sacred om into the flute, and that om knits the world together. So something about sound, about casting our spell, you know, we can even say spelling, but putting that truth out into the universe, it creates healing and it creates a sense of grounding. I am here, and this is my song.
I think this is the perfect segue to go into that very poignant message in your talk that really stuck with me. Trauma happens in isolation, healing happens in community. So tell us a little bit more about that. I think we're already there. Just elaborate on it, because I think that is such an important message.
Yeah, I found for me that there was a process that sort of happened after I was abused of just total shutdown and almost feeling like this has turned me into an alien and I will never be whole again. I am too broken to be in society and relationships who will, you know, there's a very negative spiraling that naturally I think happens after this. And so when, as a community, we're able to say, this is my story, this happened to me, and for that truth to not be, oh, I don't believe you, go away, you're too much, which is basically what that word rape culture happens to survivors. It again, it keeps these cycles of trauma and abuse just going on in someone's life. So to be able to say, okay, this happened to me, this is my truth. And the, you know, just the experience of sharing that and having someone stay, having someone say, I see you, I believe you, and I am here with you. I'm not going anywhere. That's healing. That's literally saying, okay, I'm not broken, and you know, I'm not too broken that no one can love me. I'm here. I can be again myself. I'm a part of this community And I can also trust others. I think that's a whole nother piece that I don't think I really even went into that much in my talk, but there's a whole trust level that I think survivors, we have to kind of come to knowing that the world can be a place that I can be safe, that I can express myself. So I think that ways that we can create community are like exactly what you all are doing at Talking Harps. You know, this is a community of harpists where we're exploring all different things together around harp and around music. And but I do think there's to be able for survivors to in community say, you are loved. I see you. I am here with you. That is such a huge part of healing. And then it creates the safe space for people to do that inner work and also to make choices around what kind of life they want to live, not what kind of life they think that they can, you know, kind of escape and not be triggered and hide. Because for so many years, I think this is sort of how I looked through life. And being able to find people that believed me, and also hearing other survivor story and seeing this sort of mirrored truth, and knowing that we can be there for each other and we can hold that space. Holding space for someone else and for ourselves is some of just the most basic healing and connective thing we can do for each other. So thank you for your open ears, Victoria.
Oh, it's my pleasure. And what you said there really remind me of, you know, some of the things that we're already seeing in our society, like truth and reconciliation that we're doing with our Indigenous mm-hmm. people here in Canada. And even though I might not be there to see what happened to them, being there to listen and to understand and to acknowledge, I'm just recognizing how powerful that is for survivors. And I think the other takeaway is that, you know, we're giving you the space to do the work, and so that you can thrive. And I think that is so important, because, you know, you mentioned a couple of times that the alternative is we choose to project that pain and anger back into the world, which is not what you want to do. You want to be different. And I think that is so important. And I think that's where the power of the community, by seeing each other and hearing each other, really come through. Now, the other message that you have talked about is that we can use our creativity to make that future better. And in your talk, you have actually invite the participant to do a lot of really creative things, even at the end of the talk as well. There's so much creative things in there. And we're going to have to talk about, if someone want to catch one of these talks, how they can find the information. But I want to talk about creativity, because that is something obviously we as musicians really hold near and dear to us. Can you offer us some ideas and suggestions where we can use creativity, be it, you know, maybe with ourselves or another person, or maybe a group of people, to create something, an experience maybe that can be healing? Like, what are some of your ideas around that so we can try?
Yeah, the first thing that I just want to say is that I believe the act of survival is creative. So to choose to say, okay, I'm, as I said before, not going to internalize this or hurt someone else, but I'm going to live with it in my body. I'm going to feel this trauma. I'm going to feel this pain. I'm not going to numb it. I'm going to be with it, and I'm going to let it come out my fingers. I'm going to dance it out. I'm going to harp it out. I'm going to whatever it out. That act is love, is survival. And it is what I think is the core of what it means to be a human. It's how we continue giving things to the future generations to mark who we are. It's the connection to our heart. So just to have that in mind before you do anything, I think is a great first start. So to say to yourself, I am in the process of being with my harp or my paints or whatever, and I'm going to trust this process, and I'm going to feel what I'm feeling and just let it come out. So I think to let go is a kind of first step, and to trust your heart. So that's a really great first step you can do if you're saying to yourself, oh, I want to just write something with my harp, or I want to play this in a way which feels a little more creative. Try to just change that perspective, that, you know, survival is creative and I'm going to share from my heart. And that will sort of spark something rather phenomenal that happens in your playing time. And I think the other piece of it is to play. So when, again, we survive trauma, there are these child parts of us or these parts of our brain that don't have words a lot of times, or are not these, you know, really complex, you know, parts of our brain that process logic. But these are the parts that actually create the best art, I'm sure. and can kind of feel things on a more intuitive, more symbolic level. Other things, you know, you can do, it's to even to take your harp and not the electric ones, although the like the big blue, you know, Camac that have a soundboard. But take the resonance, the castor resonance, that's French, the soundboard, and try to blow when we're talking. So right now I'm speaking, right? And I'm the la, I'm speaking this note. I think it's a la, literally. I think it's an A when I speak. And so to try to take your normal sound that you talk and to sing into your harp, to make that, you know, ohm sound into your harp and feel its vibrations and kind of feel what that inspires in you. And, you know, you can even try to play your harp at the same time that you do that and just see what that experience of trying to play your sound into your, you know, your soul.
So in the back of the harp here.
Yeah. Oh, it's incredible. I hope it's okay that I do this.
Yeah, just, absolutely. Hold on, I'm curious now.
Grab this.
Oh, wow. I can hear it.
I don't know if you guys could hear that. Could you hear the resonance?
I could.
Okay, so this is like a smaller harp, but it still is really powerful. And so just to do something as simple as that, it kind of takes your brain out of, again, this logic of it must be perfect and in this, you know, certain way, and brings you into a more playful place of creativity to connect with your inner self. And in a group, there's something called toning, which is where you get your back with someone else. And again, that might feel triggering for some people. So if that's the case, no worries. You can also do this just with yourself. But it's the process of feeling a vibration against your back or feeling your own vibration. So what you do for toning is you breathe in, and then you just sing like an om or an ah or a vowel out. And you do that until you can't breathe. But when you're doing this with another person, and it's a crazy experience, you don't actually have to think about harmonizing. You will just naturally do that with the other person. And the point in doing this isn't to make the beautiful sounds, but it's to feel the vibration, and which in it of itself is healing. So that's a really, really fabulous activity you can do with a friend or with a group of people. And the more open the space, so under a bridge, in a cathedral, in a train station, wherever you can do it, where the sound, you know, goes into the atmosphere and kind of comes back to you, it's the most powerful experience. So I think singing in a group is also, and just even simple songs, you know, This Little Light of Mine or whatever. In the talk, I wrote a really simple song that I have in a three-part harmony, and I just say, we sing together, I see you, I believe you, and I am with you. And we kind of do this on repeat. It's really basic. But to be able to feel that vibration, to have it come through your body, to be able to see other people in a space do that together, it's coming home in the biggest and most powerful way. So singing in a group, you know, it's in every shamanic or, you know, indigenous culture, there are these very simple singing rituals. And I think when we do sing together, we again tap into that communal healing, very, very basic, very, very primal, like being with your mother and her womb kind of energy.
I love that. And I often think, personally speaking, I think I sometimes overcomplicated things when I think about, you know, okay, I need to play some music in the harp for healing. And then I'm like, there's no way, I don't compose, I don't know how to write something, you know, this is not for me. But what you have done there in making the sound into the soundboard, like you said, that even feeling that vibration alone, and I'm pretty sure actually a lot of us has tried it, believe it or not, because we always feel that vibration and we think there's some kind of draw that pulls us in. And what I love about the simple exercise like that, or, you know, singing a song, like you said, a simple song with someone, that for me is a springboard to more creativity. So I really resonated with some of these, even some very simple steps that you have shared with us that lead us to other creative ventures. I love that. So if our audience in the States are interested in coming to one of these talks, where can they find your tour schedule?
So it will be on my Instagram, which is Odyssey at Sea. Odyssey, ODYSSEYATSEA. And I have my tour schedule will be up there, written down. It's on my website, www.blueharp.com. BLEW, like we're blowing into the harp, as you just did. That's why it's called that, literally. And also on Facebook, on and I believe under here, I will give you a list of where the talks will be and at what time.
We'll put that all into the video description for everyone. Now, very exciting, because I know you have bigger plans for yourself in terms of taking your work in healing and with music to the next level. Tell us what's in your future.
Yeah, so this whole decision actually sort of started after one of our talks, when I believe through it all, you said, oh, this could be a great talk. And it just sort of like, oh my goodness, this is it. So I just started to realize, and through a number of other things, these sort of talks just sort of came together. And in preparing for these talks, I had this really deep, like a gong inside of me, just saying you're meant to be a music therapist, and you need to, you know, to be able to share this on a kind of larger scale, and to, you know, create like a therapy center someday for other survivors, you need to go back to grad school. So that started a process of looking at grad schools, which would also be compatible with our family. And fun, like in a sort of hilarious turn of events, the grad school, which is the best fit, and also where my husband, who's a boat captain, could work, is New Zealand. So hello, Victoria University in Wellington. Are big announcement. We are sailing this July in this boat, and we're going to cross the Panama Canal and then go through the Marquise and Tahiti and maybe the Cook Islands, and then arrive in New Zealand. And I'm going to do a master's in music therapy, and then hopefully after a PhD in music therapy at Victoria University in Wellington. And my deep, deep hope is to be able to actually do some research around this binaural and bilateral music stimulation, and specifically work with survivors of sexual abuse and assault. Because I found for me that it was so challenging to find people that actually really understood trauma, and also were able to just not use talking therapy, but have, you know, access to this creative healing energy. Which I think more and more the creative arts are sort of taking off because people are realizing that what actually really helps is to come back into the body, to heal all of these different parts, not necessarily through talking. So I am super excited to begin on this next step of the journey. And I invite you to follow me and us on this journey. We're getting something called Starlink. So this time we will have internet, which is a bit of like a, well, you know, it's been so nice to sometimes just to be totally cut away, but we're really going to try to more actively post things and post videos and really invite people on this journey, because we also think as a family, you know, there's so much of what you should do in life and how you should be living. And I think people get lost in the shoulds, and we're really trying to live through our hearts. And part of this journey for us is also as a family choosing a place which we feel a really deep vibration with, New Zealand, and the healing energy of the earth there. So we're going to invite you along on our journey. So feel free to follow on Instagram. I think I'm also on TikTok. And we're going to try to share, you know, music, also talking about how to use healing, how to use some body and somatic exercises to come into your body. So it'll be a whole kind of crock pot of many different adventures that we're going to share.
I am so excited for you. I literally was reading an article, maybe just a couple of days, that talk about how there has been in our society a lot of push on going into, you know, the science and the technology and the math and whatnot in the higher education. And this person was talking about how we're neglecting the arts and the other sort of, you know, people would call them soft science, if you will, in university. But as I was, you know, going through my own personal journey in dealing with my own issues, listening to yours and many others' journey, I'm really realizing that there's a reason why art was such a big thing back then and continue to be a big thing. And I'm really excited that you're going to be studying it in a very intentional way. And I really admire your effort in bringing that awareness to other survivors and make them know that, yes, you can do your traditional therapy, and here is another avenue that you can explore. I really enjoy that. Thank you so much.
Oh, thank you, Victoria. Can I just add one other little
thing? Of course,
thing?
Please.
I actually am also really hoping, and this is sort of, I even said this in my interview with them, to really bring the harps into the music therapy arena, because for right now, and I understand why it is. It's very much based on the piano and the guitar, which is great. But I really do think there's a whole other level of healing and, you know, powerful transformation that happens specifically with the harp. So I'm really hoping to kind of bring that more and more. Like, you invite one harpist to do something and like 50 show up. So I'm really excited to see more and more harpists.
I think it will take off. And we're already seeing a lot of interest in people. There are some, you know, harp therapy studies out there already, I think. And also, as the harp become more accessible, I'm looking at the Odyssey, for example, right? Yeah. That's a very accessible harp that Carmack has created. And I think that would just hopefully help the harp become a staple in different settings, including therapeutic settings, for sure. I'm beyond excited for you. I'm so glad you decided to do the talk. And I'm really grateful for you to come on here and talk to us about your journey and how music have helped you and what you're gonna do with music to help others. I think it's, for me, it's a big full circle moment. Mm-hmm. I'm going to promise you, I'm gonna be bugging you in the next little while. I'm gonna ask you for some updates on what you have learned and you know, what your plans are in taking this music to others. So you'll hear from me again.
Thank you so much, Victoria. And again, thank you so much for having me. Thank you for Angela, for all you do at Talking Harps. And thank you again for using the word sexual abuse and assault in the interview. Thank you for being brave enough to talk about the more complex issues. I feel really seen and heard and held by all of you at Talking Harp. So thank you from the bottom of my heart. And I want to say that to other people that have listened to this, please take really, really good care of yourself today. Be really gentle with yourself. This has been triggering. Reach out for help. You can always send me a message on any of the, you know, ways you can contact me, but just, yeah, take really gentle, loving, good care of yourself today. And thank you for listening to this. So, and just thank you so much, Victoria.
Thank you once again.